Yes, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are. Welcome at this sports leadership webinar session. On behalf of the Amsterdam University of Applied Science and the Sports Leadership Institute, I want to welcome you all. And of course, a special welcome to all our SLP alumni, friends, faculty, former colleagues, and potential participants. We are extremely excited to see you all from all over the world, wherever you are. And we're happy to have you here at this show. And please put in the chat where you are right now. Why do we have this webinar? First of all, it's about the relaunch of the sports leadership program. 6 years ago, we started with a great initiative at Nairobi Business University to design a new program on sports leadership. And in those 6 years, we only not designed a great program, but we built a combination of ideas and legacies. And I'm extremely thankful to both Nairobi and all the alumni for building this legacy. And now, of course, it's time to make a next step. Second, we're of course here to congratulate the community, the vibrant community we have, the sports leadership community. And I'm very happy to have some alumni stories today from people that are all over the world just sharing what they are experiencing right now. And third, of course, is about talking about the importance of leadership right now at this moment of time. Because yes, the world of sports is facing a global revolution. And we need leaders that can address those changes. And we're going to speak with three alumni. And of course, we're going to speak with James Kerr about how he thinks, how he believes we can deal with disruption. But first of all, we're going to speak about what is the new program all about. And for that, we're going to switch over to the studio to two important persons that have been doing a tremendous job in the last 1.5 years by redesigning, rebuilding the sports leadership program. So we're going to switch over right now to the studio.
Good morning to you all. My name is Catalina Boerma, and on behalf of the University of Applied Sciences and the Sport Leadership Institute, I welcome you on this morning. I'm a program manager of Sportkunde track, Sport Management Ondernemen, and Sport Studies track, International Sport Management and Business. And I'm really happy to welcome you on this morning, as this is the relaunch and a partnership between the University of Applied Sciences and the Sport Leadership Program. And we've been working really hard over the last months to relaunch it, because we both share a passion for leaders in sport, for the world of sports, and especially the focus on the personal aspect and the personal development of sport leaders in sport. So the whole, I definitely want to introduce you to my colleague, which is Connie Venting, and she's going to tell you more about that track in the sport leadership program. Connie.
Thank you, Katelijne. Hi all, glad to be back. As Bartel just stated from the Olympic Stadium, and he's just coming into the studio, is that we started 6 years ago, and I'm happy to be back as well. Grateful for all the participants and all the alumni that I see in the webinar. So I see familiar faces, and I see people joining in from all across the globe. So I think it's very, it's also nice for us that we have built an alumni community that is built on, making a difference around the globe in the sports ecosystem. So what I really would like to stress is that a sports leadership's program is starting again, and that the personal development track is the core of the program. I also like to stress that, in these difficult circumstances around coronavirus, we will be building a program where the personal development track is very important, and that we are going to build the program so that it can always happen. because what we feel, especially in these difficult circumstances, is that people are really looking into programs to get together, to connect to other people, to likewise people, and to build on their personal development journey. So I'm happy to be back and that I am able to develop this program together with the University of Applied Sciences and with Bartel, the Sports Leadership Institute. So I'm happy to see the faces again, and hopefully we will be able to meet each other in person soon. And I'll hand over to Bartel to explain you a little bit more what the program will look like. Bartel, here you go.
Thanks, Connie. Yeah, we're sitting here in a great studio with all kinds of students that are monitoring all the technical details. But first, we're going to talk about the new program, that we are redesigning. And first of all, we need to talk about how is the program going to look like. We're going to go through the slides. Yeah, there we go. We're going to talk about the new program, and the program that is actually the same format with the same people. And here you see already some familiar names, some key lectures, some key persons that will be involved with the new program. But first, we go back to our history, the history where it all started 6 years ago. And of course, we started at Nairobi Business University with the design of this new program, a program for leaders that want to change sports. And here you see the class picture of the first group, the first alumni group that graduated in 2015. Sweet memories. And yes, we designed a program to foster leaders that can address those changes, the changes we just addressed, people that can view sports from a holistic perspective, can have a view from how can we foster collaboration within the sports ecosystem, within sports organizations, a program for people that are passionate about high performance, a program that is especially focused on people that can make the change. And we're going to the next slide. Well, we're gonna continue with trying to introduce the team, and we're trying to get to these to the next slides. Lapa over there, yeah. This is the program, and the next slide. There we come. Some technical problems. Yes, here of course. These are the pictures we wanted to see, because the Sports Leadership Program foremost is an international program, a program where the participants are exposed to different international cultures and to learn also from different universities. You see here the program going to Oregon with our partners at the Warsaw Sports Marketing Center, to Lausanne, to Tokyo, of course, and to London, all to learn from the international culture and perspective. And of course, we're going to the next slide. Changes are happening in sports. These are the familiar changes. How can leaders address the changes with integrity, corruption, but also changes like the emotion involved in sports? How can leaders address those changes? But also the changes involved with, for example, the legacy of international sports events. What is the legitimacy of those sporting events? Like here, the white elephants, but also the theme of healthy and urban vitality. I think especially now we need leaders that can address those themes and can incorporate a healthy living within their sports organization. Sports has a twofold relationship with society. On the one hand, society is affecting sports, but on the other hand, sports is also having a major impact on society. And of course, sports is more and more often used as a leverage for political issues, like here. But we need people that can do it in the right way, because yes, sports has the power to change the world, but you must use it in a proper way. And of course, most recently, we see the themes of social activism and social justice, and the role sports people and sports athletes can have to change these type of things. And yes, of course, we could not have imagined this 1 year ago, but with the come of COVID, sports has changed dramatically. And of course, we need leaders that can address the whole chain from crisis to giving a kind of feeling of belonging, giving a purpose to all the people involved. And I think that's quite important, especially right now. And yes, what is our new team? Because I think it's quite important to introduce our new team. Here, the first names, Liedewij and Iris from the Amsterdam University of Applied Sciences, who are responsible for all the marketing and internal organization. And yes, Jill and Peter Bos, two familiar names. Jill, program manager and responsible for all the daily operations, and Peter Bos, responsible for all the recruitment. But we've got more. We've got all the program managers of all the sports management studies of the Amsterdam University. And I think it's especially nice to see the big, broad collaboration between physical education, sports management, sports marketing, all the tracks together that are now working to create a new sports leadership program. And of course, last but not least, my business partner and good friend, Thomas Tiegelman, that helped me some tremendous in the last 1.5 years. So now going to the program, because yes, we've got the existing bachelor studies at the Amsterdam University. Yes, we've got the new executive sports leadership program with all the familiar topics. And I'll come back on that in 1 second. But the goal is to come to a final master in sports management and leadership. And that is our ultimate goal, to create a master that is available, accessible to all bachelor students, but also for the alumni. So the master is basically our final call to work. And all the alumni and bachelor graduates have a fast track access to the master in science for sports management and leadership. And our goal is to start the master in 2 years' time. So we've got a whole pyramid of programs. And I think that's a unique thing in Dutch sports management and leadership education. So now going to the program. I think the program was already great. We know the existing structures, but now we've got some new elements. And let's go to the five modules of each 4 days. And we always start with the most important familiar module, the social impact, the impact that sports has on society, but also the impact society has vice versa on sports. Frank van Eekeren will be the key lecturer on that. And yes, we're already going to start January 11th next year. So that's in 12 weeks from now. And then a new module, the second module, it will be fully online. It's all about sports and politics, influencing at the highest level the diplomacy that's involved with sports. And yes, the nice thing is all the alumni of the sports leadership program will get free access to a small part of this second module. So it will be an add-on together with some other nice add-ons for the alumni network. And then, of course, module 3, it's the oldest and maybe the most famous. It's the high performance sports module. And of course, Geert Savelsberg and Thomas Tiegelman will be involved as the key lecturer of this great high performance module. Then the fourth module, it's the sports and business, the commercial and marketing part of the sports ecosystem, especially what leadership skills do you need to address those business issues. And Henri Robbe, our famous professor, will be in charge of this fourth module. And then last but not least, it's the governance module. The governance of sports organizations, but also the funding and finance that is involved. It will be organized at Nyenrode, and Dennis Vink, Professor Dennis Vink, will be the key lecturer of this module. So I think it's a tremendous program, an existing program, but we're gonna improve it, and we're open also for new ideas, for new cases, for new themes to improve the program. It's not a fixed program. It will get better and better along the way. And yes, the world of education is changing, as you all know. So parts will be online. The program will go ahead anyway, but parts will be online together with our business partners like Oregon, the Warsaw Sports Marketing Center. So we will have huge high-end live streams with all those worldwide global partners and have an incredible, nice, inspiring education environment. So yes, we need leaders that can address those changes. We need leaders that not only have an opinion on things that are changing, but are also able to bring over their opinion, especially when they're under pressure, when they're in front of a camera, can still express their opinion. And I know a lot of you guys, a lot of our alumni right now in the show, each have an incredible experience during the last year. And it's sad that we don't have the time to go all over through to all our alumni to hear the often very personal stories. But I do want to pick out a couple of alumni that very shortly share their story. And I first want to go to India, because I know in India there is an alumni of the first batch, SLP1, who is the national coach of the national field hockey team. And I think from all the coaches, he's one of the persons that's in the longest isolation that's possible. So let's go to Sjoerd Marijnen. Sjoerd, are you on the show?
Yes, I'm there.
Yes, he's there.
I'm there, Bartel.
Oh, it's so great to see you. Can you just share what are your most beautiful moments and the most horrible moments of the last months you experienced?
I will start with the horrible moments. It's like I'm already almost 9 months without family. I had a break in the summer for 6 weeks. That was it. So 4.5 months. And now I'm going till 12th of December. So that is for me the most difficult thing on the moment.
I can imagine. And how do you survive these moments without nothing?
Yeah, it's living day by day and really focusing on what you can control. It's a really challenge, of course, in your mindset. And as a coach, you're always telling your players what to do. It's really easy from the sideline. But now you have to deal it yourself with this situation. And I also have my tough moments and I share them with my family. And luckily, there's FaceTime. I think it's really important also to express them. So that's the way it works for me.
And now the good part of this are the good parts, because you are in preparation of the Olympics. The Olympic Games in Tokyo. Are there parts that you can also hold on?
Yeah, absolutely. Like I have my team 24/7 with me, so that gives a lot of opportunities. Despite we only can train, it would be good to play matches, but okay. So we can control a lot of things, what we do with the team. We can really look to our opponents, make really deep analyses. And the other thing is like the time you get, I like to use it on a useful way. And that's, for instance, I wrote a book, create a few companies on these kind of things. So that also helps me to take this period on a good way.
Well, Sjoerd, I think I talk on behalf of the entire sports leadership community that we wish you all the best. And somehow we want to see you accelerating at the Olympics. Good luck.
Thank you. Same to you.
So we're going to another alumnus of the sports leadership second batch, second class. He is the sporting director of the cycling team Lotto Visma. He's not only alumnus of the sports leadership program, but also alumnus of the Havia Amsterdam University. And foremost, he is passionate about sports. And that's, of course, Marijn Zeeman. Marijn, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning. I think you have an incredible year that started with huge ambitions at the beginning before Corona. Some incredible tournaments. Just my first question, how did you experience these last 10 months?
It was absolutely a roller coaster. Crazy year with but also a lot of some downs. Worldwide, it was of course a very hectic year, maybe a horrible year, but yeah, for our team, we also achieved a lot of fantastic results. And actually, today is a very exciting day for us, because today we have to defend the red jersey in the Vuelta a España. It can be even better today. But so exciting day today as well.
Looking back to those last 10 months, what lessons have you learned, if you now look back to all those moments, the good moments, maybe the difficult moments? What lessons do you take out of these last 10 months?
Yeah, well, I think the main thing is when the coronavirus was there and suddenly everything stopped, we went into a lockdown, the competition stopped. And I think the most important thing is to learn to how to behave in a crisis, and also to keep looking forward and keep believing in your dreams and also work for that. So actually when the lockdown was there, actually I was sick myself as well. So the first 2 weeks I had the coronavirus, but then I already realized that that a lot of opponents were just accepting the lockdown and stop everything. A lot of teams in cycling, actually they were in big problems. They stopped paying. Some teams really had to struggle to survive. But I think the thing what we did very well was immediately seeing an opportunity, and also to realize that you can do things better than your opponents, and also to keep the group together. So we are a cycling team. We have a speed skating team, but a lot of people are working in our organization. So around 150 people, and they were all at home. So I realized very well that we had to keep the group together, and also to make a transparent communication about everything, about sharing the ideas, sharing the fears, but also making people aware that it is also an opportunity, and that we can come out stronger. And actually, everything what we built for, almost everything we succeeded in. The coronavirus really gave us that opportunity. That is something what I'm actually really proud of, what we did together. Unfortunately, the big dream or the big goal was the yellow jersey in the Tour de France. I think everyone knows that we lost it on the last day, but still the journey towards the Tour and the way we work together, that gave me a lot of pleasure and a lot of proud as well.
You're talking about the values, dealing with uncertainty, the emotions and fears of your team, of your colleagues. How do you now prepare for the coming period with all the uncertainty still ahead?
Yeah, well, I think in cycling, we found actually a very good way to continue the competition. So in our sports, of course, it's not indoors, so that's already a difference. And we are able to create bubbles with very strict testing and also very strict behavior. When you are inside the bubble, like shoot, we are not allowed to have contact with the outside world, and we have to be very disciplined and very strict in the rules and applying the rules. And I think it's, for now, it's important to make everyone aware that professional sports is still possible. Of course, it's not easy, but I think we are getting used to it now. And so for us, it gives also for 2021 a lot of possibilities to continue. And also that we know that to expect that the competition will go through, and that you have to prepare for it. Because sometimes around me, I see people like they are a little bit pessimistic, or they don't believe in the competition that it will go through. But actually, everything was there. Every competition went through. So we have to keep on preparing for the new season. And I believe that our team is ready for that.
Is there one part of your own leadership that has been exposed most in these last 10 months? If you look back, what personal part of your own leadership has been the most interesting developing element of this journey in the last period?
Yeah, I think, I mean, the project what we are in now, so we are now in 2020, and for now I can say that we are one of the best teams in the world, but we were not when we started this journey. So actually, we were lying on the ground. There was a lot of uncertainty. There was even a possibility of a shutdown of the team. And we started with core values and really bottom up we built up this team, defining our culture, defining our core values. And actually, in the coronavirus, these core values, they were the most important. The athletes are important, the training is important, but mainly the organization and all the people involved are important. And I think the things what we really brought us together was giving attention to each other, stay with each other, transparent communication, and really taking care of all the people in the organization. And that's what we said in the beginning of 2017, that as one of the most important core values of this team. And in 2020, it really paid off because this team was stronger after the lockdown than before. And I think it also gave us the base to fight and to continue innovating, to continue working hard, keep believing in our dreams. So in the end, it turned out that 2020 was the most successful year of this organization, but also that a lot of people really, really felt that they were part of this organization and that they were really valued. That makes us really proud.
Well, we are proud on you. And on behalf of everyone, we want to wish you all the best and continue with this great story. Good luck today. And we hope to see all the sweet victories coming next year. And we're sure it's going to happen. Thank you so much, Marijn.
You're welcome.
Yeah, and then we go to another alumnus of the SLP 3 batch class. He is actually the youngest CEO of a Dutch Premier League club. And he started 1 year ago, and he could not foresee the changes that would come. Of course, I'm talking about Wouter Gudde, CEO of FC Groningen. Wouter, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Martin.
Also the same story for you. How did you experience these last 10 months? Because it must be an incredible journey for you guys as well.
Yeah, I think the same as Marijn already said. For us, it was also a roller coaster, but it was also a very uncertain period. We played with FC Groningen the last game of the Eredivisie last season, and on the 8th of March against PSV, we lost it, by the way, with 1-0. 2 days after, the next round of the competition got cancelled. And my first thought was maybe it was a bit simple, but I think, okay, we're going to have to wait for 2 or 3 weeks. And after that, we're going to play football again. But after 3 weeks, the situation become worse and worse and worse. Then I asked my operational director to give me a report with especially the financial numbers when we become in a situation that we cannot finish the competition at all. And then I saw that we had a big problem at FC Groningen because we were a club with a negative equity, not a good cash flow, and we had a possible damage of around the 5 million euros. So then we could we made a plan because we could do two things. We could wait until we got help, or we could fight. Now we made a plan to secure the 5 million. It was a hard plan because I had to fire 17 people. I had to do all the budget cuts I could get. I also had to cut the transfer budget because we have to reform our whole squad because we sold two strikers, we sold two defenders, and I also had to have a budget to invest in the squad. And that was a difficult situation to explain, especially to the fans and to all the people who follow football, that you On the other hand, you have to fire 70 people, but you still can buy a player. But I think we choose the right strategy because we cut, we did everything we could ourselves. And then after that, we ask help. We started a campaign with the name Laat ons weer eens juichen. It's from our club song, from our anthem. And we asked, especially our supporters and our sponsors, to do the simple thing not to ask your money back because we did not play the last 8 games, and renew your season ticket and renew your sponsor contract to help the club. And now we did that with all the action. We visit 3,000 season ticket holders at home. The whole north was almost green. People started all actions to get money for the club, after 3 or 4 months, we were able to hold the whole 5 million within the club. Also because we could launch the transfer of Arjen Robben. We at Ascension Day, me and the technical director went to Munich, and Arjen wanted to help the club. And the best way to help the club is to get on in your football shoes. And he decided to make a comeback. And after that comeback, the whole Groningen province exploded. And we sold almost 4,000 season tickets in a weekend. Sold 4,000 jerseys in a weekend. Sold our skyboxes in a week. So now the situation is stable, but still uncertain. And it was very hectic, also as Marijn already said.
So from a leadership perspective, you had to make some big decisions the last months, some difficult ones, some nice decisions. But how did you, as a leader, to take your whole team with you to keep them motivated and inspire them to go forward, even despite the difficult decisions you had to make?
Yeah, we involved the whole company in the campaign to let us help the supporters and fans. So it was really tough and also hard, because on the 11th of May, I have to fire 17 of their colleagues. And on the 12th of May, the day after, we started with the campaign, and everybody got a part of the campaign and had to go out on the street, visit season ticket holders, visit sponsors. But because we did that, everybody get new energy, because we had one goal. We had to save the club. We don't have any equity, no cash flow. So there was not another option. And because we did that, the group of people get along very well eventually. And maybe it's a hard thing to say, but also the organization is doing well now. Of course, we miss the people, but we can work fine right now. So that's also a big lesson I've learned. I've waited too long to reorganize because I made my analysis way earlier, but I waited until COVID happened to finalize, because there was no other option. And that's what I've learned from this situation. Maybe when I have a next job, I will restructure it even farther, because it was necessary.
And now looking forward, with all the uncertainty still ahead, how do you are going to plan and deal with the coming period with your organization and your team?
Yeah, we changed the consultation structure. We work more in teams now. So because all of the government rules, the situation could change by the day. So we have 2 COVID teams, one for the sports department, especially for our football players, and one for the stadium, because sometimes you can play with a small audience. Then we now, this situation, we play with no audience. But I hope this season we can grow to more audience in the stadium. The last 3-4 weeks, we finished the company policy plan. It's also finished now. We also combined it with the whole organization. But we have 2 big challenges, because I think the situation will stay until this, for sure, until December or January. So we need to ask our sponsors and supporters again to give their money back, to help the club again. So we're going to start a new campaign, which is combined with our new policy plan. But the big challenge, I think, for whole football is what are fans going to do after a period of one season without visiting your favorite team in the stadium? What are they going to do with their leisure activities? Do you want to go to the stadium so bad that you cannot wait to come? Or maybe the visit to your parents-in-law on Saturday or Sunday are so great that you never go to the stadium again? So the big challenge is to interact with all the targeted groups within your organization from time to time. The next 3 weeks now coming, we're going to call our 1,000 oldest season ticket holders just to ask them how they're doing, and also the players involved in that in the calls, just to keep them informed, to keep them with our club. But yeah, when this situation hold on for 5, 6, 7 months, I think the biggest challenge is to get everybody back to the stadium.
Thank you, Wouter, for sharing this very personal story and spending your busy schedule with us. And again, we wish you all the best. And of course, together with all the other SLP alumni that are involved with football, continue with improving, making football even better as it is now. Thank you so much, Wout.
Wouter, good luck.
Yeah, Wouter and Marijn, they are both talking about values, about how do you create a culture in the end that makes the difference, and where all the team members are knowing where they can fall on if everything is unknown. Leaders are great learners. And I think there is one book that's talking about leadership, culture, learning, and high performance as no other book. And that's, of course, the book Legacy. And a lot of you, I think, almost all alumni, and please wave your hand if you have read the book Legacy, because it's a kind of Bible manifest of the sports leadership program. And of course, I'm talking about the book Legacy from James Kerr. And I'm extremely privileged, happy that James Kerr is right now with us to not only share a little bit about, of course, the book Legacy, but also to already tell a little bit about this new book that's still not out, but we're the first group that heard a little bit about this book. James, welcome to the show. Where on this planet are you?
I'm speaking to you from London. It's great to be here. Thanks everyone for tuning in. You know, values and disruption, I guess, what have they got to do with each other? I wanted to talk a little bit, as Bartel says, about a little bit, just a snippet from Legacy, and a little bit, and then drift into taking us to Everest with the Gurkhas and the Sherpas to look at how they deal with some aspects of upset, of an unexpected event, and the impact that that had on their group. So if you'll excuse me for a moment, I'm just going to do that awkward moment where I bring up some slides. And I wanted to start a little bit with the All Blacks, really just to set the scene and really to talk about the idea of ethos, the code that groups live by, because I think that becomes increasingly important. A couple of the previous speakers or guests have talked about that importance of values and a purpose and of cohesion and connection, compassion, all of those things. And I think if you get your ethos right, if you know what you stand for, you know what you don't, you know where you're going, and you know why it matters, you can bring your group along and be there for each other in a way that's profoundly different than if you don't activate that kind of way of looking and that kind of way of thinking. The All Blacks are known obviously for the haka. Other than rugby, they're known for the haka. The sound of the haka is the sound of the earthquake. And Maori believe, the original people in New Zealand believe, that that sound is now uru uru, and it shakes the earth and it splits it open and releases our ancestors from the soil to our soul to stand beside us in our struggle here on earth. It's based on the idea of ancestry, of lineage, of legacy, representing all those who have come before us in our lineage and all those who will come after. And we're all linked in arm in this long chain of human beings. And the sun shines for a moment, but just for a moment on this time, on our time. And it reminds us that we have a fleeting moment, whatever circumstances throws at us, to make our mark, to fulfill our potential, our purpose, to be a good ancestor, to add to the legacy, or as the All Blacks say, to leave the jersey in a better place. And it's this core purpose, this core idea that sits right at the heart of the All Blacks. And it helps propel them to some quite extraordinary, it's by no means the only reason they've been so successful over such a long period of time. Their structures are great. Their focus on coaches and competitions as a talent pathway. It's a small country, but not too small. So there's a huge visibility of talent. It's a single sport nation, pretty much. It's a religion. almost for Kiwis. But that doesn't really help when you get onto the into the jersey. You know, what is so the interesting thing, I think, is that mindset that clusters around purpose, that creates a culture, that creates the environment for exceptional high performance and exceptional resilience in a very competitive environment. They're arguably the most successful sporting team on the planet. They played 125 years. The win ratio is something like 78% of all encounters. They've only lost at home 39 times. They've been ranked world number one for twice as long as the rest of the world combined. They've won 3 World Cups. Till relatively recently, they held all the silverware it's possible to own in their sport. So they're extraordinarily successful, and they sort of have this edge, and they keep getting better all the time. Whatever fate throws to them, it seems, they're able to reinvent and re-galvanize and go on to the next challenge and prevail. I spent a lot of time with the team, worked with a couple of books with them and co-creating them in many ways with them. One of my heroes in the team is a guy called Wayne Smith, an assistant coach. And I asked him about leadership. And this is one of the things he said, that exceptional success requires exceptional circumstances. That one of the key responsibilities, I guess, of a leader is to create the exceptional circumstances, the environment, the culture around the people. And there's an equation they use for it, that the performance you get is equivalent to your talent, your capability multiplied by your behavior. You know, what that really means is the score at the end of the day, however you measure that, is equivalent to your talent, both as a team and as individuals. And that's multiplied, what the military would call a force multiplication effect, by the way you behave, by the soft stuff, by the way you connect, by the way you communicate, by the way you look after each other, by the clarity of vision that you have, by the hundreds and thousands of small things, those marginal gains that is brought about by your everyday behavior. And that behavior is conditioned by the environment that leadership creates around that team, by the example you set as a leader, by the code you live by the ethos of that team, by that culture. And so, and I think this is even, this is, as a couple of the previous guests said, you know, talking about core values and compassion and connection and caring and all of those things. This is 100 times more important now than it is when life isn't normal, I think. You know, how do we create that kind of ethos and connection in a socially distanced world? Bubbles force it in many ways, but they also create a lot of possible dysfunctions, isolation, irritation, you know, factionalization, all of those things. So from a leadership point of view, how do we create common cause and the cohesion that any great team needs to both survive and thrive in a competitive environment? A few quick examples of how the All Blacks do this. This is Poss, he's the kit guy. He reckons he's got the best job in the world, which is to lay out the All Blacks jerseys before a game. This is game day, about 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The players come up and collect their prize. Richie McCaw says every time he pulls it on, it's like pulling it on for the first time, this iconic jersey. It has genuine meaning for the team. And one of the meanings is that it's a sacred object. It's there to be respected. And so you'll never see an All Blacks jersey thrown down with the mud and the blood and the strapping on the floor. The players will hang it up always. And that really illustrates the respect for the jersey, but not just that respect is an action. It's not just words. Plenty of organizations have their values up on the wall. You know, I talk to business groups, and Enron's a great example of those of you who remember Enron. One of their values was integrity. And of course, you know, they were cooking the books. But the great groups, and again, this is something that came up in the first few guests, focus on fundamental values, and not just the core values, but how do you live those values out loud? How do you turn them into actions that make a difference to other people? You know, otherwise it's just empty words, but really, how do you create that kind of action? Secondarily, I just wanted to talk a little bit about environment and about storytelling. There's a saying in the team that the story you tell yourself turns out to be the story that others tell about you. You know, you want a fantastic story. You want your narrative to really kick ass, if you like. One of the, you know, an obvious way of doing that, Gilbert and Oka, the mental skills coach, A Kiwi hangs a Kiwi flag, an obvious symbol of representation. Maybe less obvious is POS. The background pulls out a suite. They're called jet planes. They're kind of wine gum shaped like a jump jet. And every Kiwi boy and girl remembers these when they're in the playground. And so when an All Black grabs one before he goes out and plays for his country, he's reminded what it meant to him to be an All Black back when he was 5 or 6 years old. They embed the meaning of that team, that purpose, the leaving the jersey in a better place, respecting the jersey, uniting and inspiring a nation, taking their place in a kind of pantheon of history. And that story is told and retold and told in fresh ways because it's a generative way to co-create meaning, commitment, connection, collaboration, contribution, all of those great C words that great teams are really about. And then the debrief is done in a particular way. And I'm sure many of you work in a similar way, but I think it illustrates a number of things that everybody has their say and everyone is expected to have their say. This is about 90 minutes after a game. And this kind of debrief has two main functions. You know, a game looks very different up the front than it does at the back or from the stands. So it's critical that we don't become blinkered as leaders and just have our point of view about what happened out there on the pitch. And by mixing it up, by calling for contributions and creating a genuine dialogue, it's the beginning of genuine learning. There are multiple perspectives coming in, and it can be very easy to forget that, I think, as leaders. Secondarily, because everybody has their say, everybody is expected to have their say, it creates that sense of connection, voice, and ownership. Wayne Smith has a fantastic line. He says, people rise to a challenge if it's their challenge. So by creating a genuine sense of co-creation, of contribution and a personal ownership, you create that huge degree more of connection, cohesion and discretionary effort. And that's tremendously powerful, particularly in adversity. You know, it can be very easy, and it's under stress, we tend to default to command and control as leaders. But the most powerful way is collaboration and co-creation and creating a dialogue that people can bring themselves to the game and feel part of the solution. The other thing, and I'll come back and summarize how this all fits together towards the end, but is what happened next. Rather than this was about 2 hours after the game, somebody clapped their hands and said, okay lads, it's time to go. And rather than the All Blacks grabbing their bags and heading for the bus, famously now they grabbed long-handled brooms and started tidying up after themselves, taking care of business, leaving the world in a better place than they found it. What better metaphor for a legacy? Or as they say, living the values out loud. The All Blacks' core values are these: humility, excellence, and respect. Respect, self-respect, respect for your teammates, respect for your competition, respect for the jersey. Excellence to be the best team in the world and to win every game, an absolute standard. And humility, though it looks like the weakest word there, but in many ways is the strongest. You know, never be too big to do the small stuff that needs to get done. Don't get ahead of yourself. Sweep the shed, stay humble, stay hungry. Just because you're world's number one, prepare like you're number two. And that focus on values, on ethos, is hugely important in what they call creating the being of team. You will have seen this metaphor that the leader does the hard work, creates uplift for those behind them. Those behind honk and encouragement create uplift for those who come behind them. If one bird should drop off to the side, another bird will help them regain the flock because care and compassion are fundamental to any great team. And then if one bird should drop back into formation, the leader has to drop back into formation, there'll be another bird there to take their place. One captain, but 15 leaders. Leadership at every level, a CEO in every position, that distributed leadership model, the killer app of collaboration, of ownership, and of discretionary effort. So that's the ethos they're trying to create. That's the code that they're trying to put into place. And I, for the purposes of this, I wanted to take you to Everest and just look at how another code, very, very similar but different, kind of has the same kind of effect. This was my home for about 6 weeks. This is Everest Base Camp. I was there with the Gurkhas, the British contingent of the British Army for the book I'm working on and still working on at the moment. They're an extraordinary outfit, and their code, their ethos is called Kaida. And Kaida interestingly enough, is fundamentally the same as the All Blacks. Humility, excellence, respect, and what they call loyalty, which is fundamentally leaving the jersey in a better place. It's the same stuff in a different suit. And I don't think that's a coincidence, because I think anthropologically, they're the fundamentals of what make great teams great. You've got to have humility, because, you know, the dickhead factor, for want of a, for using the New Zealand phrase, will draw a team, you know, to destruction. Excellence in all things, that excellence as a habit, is fundamental. And a sense of genuine respect for the roles that each other play. And a sense of your place in history, that you're making a contribution to something bigger than yourself, that there's a purpose beyond just playing. And those factors are fundamental for any great team, I think. I'm going to quickly take you up Everest. This is the journey up the Khumbu. You'll see that all the structures really look like the mountains. These are stupas. This is Hillary's village, like something from Tintin in Tibet. That's Everest there poking its head out from behind Nupsi. This is base camp. It's a pretty brutal existence up there. The key issue is altitude. It's about 50% less air at base camp than anywhere else, but base camp itself seems safe. You know, the real danger is the Khumbu icefall and Everest and the heights above. On April the 25th, 2015, people were living their life in base camp. This is Budi, one of the Gurkhas, when this happened. And I'm hoping it's going to play. Bartel, will you give me a thumbs up that we're seeing this? Thank you.
The ground is shaking.
This is the earthquake hitting.
Oh, come out of my jacket. Come out of my jacket.
So, it was the deadliest day in Everest history. 10,000 people died in Nepal at that moment. It was an extraordinarily cataclysmic moment that came from the side. And what I was interested in, how do people bounce back from that? How do you deal with that kind of adversity? Now, we're clearly in a seismic event of another sort at the moment. So it's an analogy, obviously, but I think there are some things that we have in common, that this kind of event has in common in terms of the impact that it has, and particularly on this Gurkha team. In 2017, they came back and they climbed the mountain. In fact, they roped the mountain for the first time. So what did it take for them to do that? And for the purpose of sort of brevity, I just wanted to come down and give you five sort of key things to think about. In terms of how they use their ethos, if you like, to bounce back against adversity. The first is around clarity of intent, vision. And I think one of the things that leaders are called on most at the moment is in a world that is what the military would call VUCA, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. You know, volatile, everything's changing. It's uncertain, which creates huge anxiety. It's complex. How do we work it out? Ambiguous. How do we make great decisions? Their way of looking at it is, we'll take VUCA. You know, VUCA then stands for vision, understanding, compassion, and cohesion. And that leads to the agility that they require. So vision, we set a clear vision so people have a common cause to work against. Chunking a season, having some rebooted goals. Understanding, making sure that you have that understanding and ownership at every level of the organization, from right at the very top to the kit guy or whoever's selling programs, really embedding what we're doing and why we're doing it. And then cohesion, or which really is positioned as care, as compassion. How do you connect that team and bring them together? At this time, in, you know, almost anthropologically, it's our responsibility as leaders, I believe, to be the village elder, to be that person that people can turn to that brings the group together, because that's how groups survive, is by that sense of togetherness. We're much stronger together as units. And the size of a sports unit, 15, 20 people, 30 people, tends to be the kind of the anthropological grouping that people cluster together after something disastrous. The tents, for instance, that people came together tended to be about 15 to 30 people in one unit. That's really how human beings come together. And of course, that's the same size as a sporting unit generally. The second thing is an extension of that, which is connection. Finding ways to create cohesion. Strong teams are cohesive teams. There's a lot of data on, you know, on the connections between human beings and between teams, both in terms of practical playing terms, but also accelerated by social connection. And so leaders who are the social glue, if you like, are more than ever required now, I believe. The third thing is, and that's another subset of it, is compassion. As I say, being the shoulder to cry on or lean on, having genuine conversations, candid conversations, with other human beings. We all have a common enemy at the moment. You know, we all have something that we are all against in many ways. And we've also gone into people's homes in a way and lives in a way that's profoundly different than we have in the past. You know, we get to look at people's bookshelves, their cats or their kids run across their keyboards. You know, we're getting to know each other in a profoundly different and more informal way. And caring for each other, of course, is an extraordinarily powerful part of this thing. The fourth really is, and I think one or two of the guests talked about this, is controlling the controllables. You know, seeing what it is an opportunity. I've always loved the story of Daley Thompson, the British decathlete, who was asked what his favorite day of the year is. And he said, Christmas Day. And they said, and the interviewer said, what, you like the presents and the food? And he said, no, I know no other bastard is out there training. And I think that's a fantastically strong way to, excuse my language, but I think that's an extraordinarily strong way to be thinking about this opportunity, is that everybody is playing on an uneven playing field now. And those who own empty stadiums, those who understand the use of time, those who are able to better manage the situation are going to be the teams that prevail in the long term, not just survive, but thrive, you know, given the fact that everybody has taken a body blow in one way or another. And the final thing really is about character. The All Blacks say better people make better All Blacks. I think better people make better just about everything. And I think the self-development around some of this, if we look at the Gurkhas, some of the phrases around character and culture for the Gurkhas, do the right thing on a difficult day is their sort of mantra. Do the right thing on a difficult day, however difficult it gets, be the difference, be the person who does things right, treat people right, make the tough calls, stand for something, understand your values, be those values. Don't be the short-termist who just kind of reacts and does whatever sort of seems to be expedient at the time, but do the right thing on a difficult day. Be the change, you know, represent that change. Don't expect everyone to do the stuff that you don't do. And one of the other phrases that came out from the Gurkhas is leadership is being responsible for the result, whatever that result is. Leadership is being responsible for the result, whatever that result is. So if it goes well or if it goes badly, it's on you. And that includes giving away credit when it goes well, but taking the blame when it goes badly, but owning that result and being having total integrity about that responsibility. So, you know, kind of five C's, I guess, you know, clarity, that vision thing, you know, providing that kind of clear ray of hope for people. Connection, co-creating, cohesion, bringing people together, becoming that connective tissue. Compassion, we're in a time of the requirement of great caring. Control the controllables, couple of an extra C in there. And character, and being of good character. And those factors certainly help create the conditions, the environment in which people need to come together in adverse and VUCA situations. So the Gurkhas, I'll just play this for a moment. This is what happens in base camp when you get a victory. I won't make you endure that too long, but basically that's a Sherpa getting a gas bottle and beating it with an ice axe. And at that point, all the other Sherpas put their heads out of their tents, reach back inside, grab a bottle of whiskey, and bring that whiskey across the moraine and across the glacier to the winning team, if you like, where they drink all night and celebrate their victory together. And it's that sense of spirit of togetherness, of coming together, of all being part of a common cause, having that combined purpose that's so fundamental in overcoming the kind of adversity you find on Everest, you find on a rugby field, you find on any sports field. And at the moment, I think, as societies fighting about life. So I hope that's interesting. I forgot to make a call for questions, but please throw some questions to me. Bartel might have one or two. He can get things going. And it'd be great to have a short 10-minute, 15-minute conversation if that brings up any stuff for you guys.
Questions are coming in, but maybe to start, how is the last period, the last 10 months for you as an author to write this new book? How did you experience it yourself?
Well, I think it's and in some ways, and I think one of your previous guests said that, you know, there's a lot of, there seems to be more time in life, although it still goes pretty quickly. So I was on hundreds of flights last year, traveling around, working with teams and speaking and so on. And I haven't been in an airport since pretty much the day it started. So that's given me a lot more time to focus on creating that IP, if you like, creating that intellectual property. And so, you know, I've just kind of seized that moment and thought of that as an advantage. You know, health-wise, it's been good not to be on planes. And also in terms of productivity, it's been really good. And I've enjoyed that sort of transition to a more online world. You know, I only have to dress from the waist up nowadays, if you like. And you know, in many ways, that's a change and a relief. I do think we all have to deal with the effects of isolation, of disappointment, of you know, anxiety about what's next. I mean, I think they're very real issues. And I think some of the resilience skills that sport teaches us, I think, and it would be, is a fantastic thing to spread out actually into the wider community, because I think sport is really quite good at that, coming back to the moment, dealing with defeat. One of the best analogies I've had around resilience is, you know, make sure the chair you're sitting on is balanced. You know, we have our work, you know, every chair has four legs. You know, make sure we don't sit on one, which is our work or our performance or whatever. You know, on one leg, sure, that's important. On another leg, family is obviously increasingly important in this environment. You know, I think one thing, when the tide's gone out, everyone's really understood some core values about being a human being. The other thing is stay physical. You know, look after yourself in a physical sense. I'm speaking to a sports community, you know, generally people are pretty good at that, but not always, not necessarily me. And a sort of some sort of spiritual sense, some sort of sense that there is, that it isn't all material. And that for people, some people that'll be God, and for some people that'll be music, and for some people that'll be nature. But making sure we have a sense of balance at this time, because that gives us true individual resilience, I think. And it's something I've sort of tried to work with a bit.
Well, we do have some questions from Wim Biesterfeld, SLP1. Good to see you, Wim. How about another sea of confidence? Always stay confident, show confidence in your purpose and result. What do you think about that, James?
Yeah, I think absolutely. I think I think real confidence comes almost from that humility, actually. You know, the authenticity and coming back to that. You know, clearly as leaders, we need to, project confidence. We need to, and I think that comes under that vision clarity side of things. To maintain that, you know, the cadence, a positive cadence, I think extraordinarily important, clearly. You know, they talk in political campaigning, there are two messages. There's either fear or hope. Hope for better things is the most powerful and persuasive argument a politician can make. We're seeing it at the moment in the US, we think, maybe, probably, who knows. And I think particularly at a time of a VUCA time where things are really messed up, having the confidence to create that kind of clarity and that sense of destiny, if you like, or a purpose, is, you know, clearly extraordinarily important. That's the motive force for for human motivation. So being able to step into that breach and be that for a group of people is really the, as I say, the anthropological need, I think, for leaders at the moment.
An interesting question from Nikolai. In the All Blacks situation, Gilbert Enoka is the person that addresses the mental part of the game where many players have praised his work. How important do you think the mental practice in this success is for the sports team?
I think it's vital, and I think it's still in its extraordinarily early days, actually. Rugby, the background I come out of, a team psychologist was a taboo subject not that long ago. Gilbert is now actually the assistant manager, but for a long time he was the mental skills coach, because people would talk to a mental skills coach, but they wouldn't talk to a psychologist or a team psychologist. And that's clearly changing, but you know, it doesn't make any sense to work your body and work your to get fit, to get tactically astute, you know, to be skills based, and not to work on mindset and decision making and leadership and ownership and resilience and your resilience to pressure. It makes no sense not to do that. It's largely been in the domain of the coach or the manager, the key coach. I think what the All Blacks have shown really well, and some more progressive teams around the world are showing really well, is that it's a specialist subject, and that actually the selector coach is not the best person necessarily. Well, create the climate, absolutely, and needs the psychology and all of that, but it's not the best person to be a safe space for players to come to. Because, you know, it maybe shows weakness. You might not get the nod for next Saturday or next Sunday. So distributing that model is, I think, is really important. But, you know, it's the top 2 inches, isn't it? It's the critical 2 inches. And you know, I think one of the opportunities at the moment is that it is such an uncultivated area. You know, the All Blacks have been doing this for a long time. They took between 2004 and 2014, where they really started to work the mind game. But really in 04, really they started to work the mind game. At 04, they were running at 75% win ratio, over 115 years thereabouts. Between 2004 and 2014, they took that win ratio up to 95%. Now, it's not just the mind game, but it had a lot to do with it. They had a core of 5 or 6 key players. They built the team around the cohesion factor, some very good coaching. They created a new haka. They focused on pressure, but they took their results up roughly 20% over a decade. And they were already the top performing team in the world by a long way, the best sporting stat already. And they banged 20% on top of it. It's still going up. So don't tell me that the mind game, if done right, doesn't create a material impact to success. I think that coaches who neglect that are just doing what was always done. And, you know, why wouldn't you create that competitive advantage? The difficulty is getting somebody to pay for it often.
So here we've got a very interesting question. We've seen two examples of male teams, male leadership. Will there be some difference from your perspective for women leadership? It's a question from Kim.
Yeah, listen, a great question. And I am aware that it's been quite blokey in terms of my examples. Listen, I think the principles are fundamentally the same. Sometimes the values might be different. For instance, if you look at the US women's football team, soccer team, humility wasn't part of their value set. And I think that was very deliberate. You know, they were cocky, they were provocative, they have been. They've been drinking cups of tea on score-going celebrations. They've been unashamed. And I think that value set reflects the fact that women have been expected to be in their place and stay humble and, you know, all of that kind of thing. And so sometimes you need to create a value set that's an antidote to the limitations that are placed upon you. But the principle, you know, to cohere around a set of common values, to have a clear vision of the future and to have a real sense of purpose and sort of manifest destiny, to create an environment around yourself that brings the best of yourself out, I think all of those things are absolutely the same. To have an ethos within your team and that ethos set the sort of the mental conditions, absolutely the same.
So many of the participants are involved in a sports organization, a club or a team. And the question now is, and it's a question from Martina, is there a technique you can find or understand what the purpose of your team or club is? Are there techniques for that?
Yeah, there's processes for that. You know, the way I look at it is, it's a three-step process, really, of define, design, and deliver. You know, you need to ask the questions like, who are we and what do we stand for and why are we going? And I'll come back to that in a second. You need to then design the environment around that. What's your language, what your symbols, your rituals, your processes, your practices. And then you need to empower people to deliver that day by day and reward and recognize the right behaviors. But in terms of the definition, it's really about a conversation or a series of conversations. Who are we? Why does what we do matter? I'm actually working on two books at the moment, and the second of the book is really that how-to manual a little bit. And one of the techniques in it is what I call leading questions. You know, what are the questions that you need to ask your people to elicit some sort of sense of agreement around who we are and why what we do matters. There are some good techniques, you know. Write a eulogy, write the thing that the speech that somebody would make at your funeral. It sounds kind of morbid, but think ahead about what it is you wanted to bring about. You know, the interesting thing about eulogies is it's not a CV. It's not your achievements. It's your character. It's the impact that you made on the world. And I think thinking in terms of impact, and particularly in sport at the moment, you know, my question around sport at the moment is, how can sport bring a socially distanced world back together? You know, it might start to answer the idea of why does it matter for people to come back into stadiums? You know, what can sport do for people, not what people, fans, can do for sport, I think is the right question at the moment. You know, why is it relevant? And I think it's more relevant than ever. But that's hugely purposeful, I think, in terms of divided communities. There's going to be some impoverished communities. A lot of people have suffered in a lot of ways. You know, my question to sport from a purpose point of view is, well, what can sport do about it? And what can you do for your local community and your supportive community and make it a social project? I don't know if I've answered your question, but, you know, maybe there's some thoughts on that.
Well, there's another question that looks a little bit familiar. Imagine you're now a board member of an international sports federation and you have to deal with good governance. How can you translate these kind of value purpose in a difficult, complex, red tape environment and still translate to good governance?
Yeah, I mean there are principles of good governance that come from business schools or business practice that are unchanged. I think in a way it comes back to those values. You know, do the right thing on a difficult day, set up something that works. And it's also partly about vision. You know, one of the things that I think from a governance point of view that sport hasn't done very well in the past, on an overarching thing, is there is a lot of internal tension in sport between club and country, for instance. But you know, great sports teams require cohesion. They require alignment. They require alignment between different parts of a football club, for instance. You know, the front offices should be the same team as the team on the pitch. And from a, you know, an overarching kind of larger governance thing, finding a way to really align the effort of an organization is a major challenge. Governance in the sense of being a generative force for positive outcomes rather than a regulatory kind of constraint, I think is the best way to look at it. And a values-based approach is a very strong place to start on that, because if you know what you stand for and you know what you don't, a lot of those sort of governments and implementation decisions kind of take care of themselves, I think. They become more obvious. But the other thing on governments is, you know, is really just setting up football, sport, whatever, to be a force for good in many ways. You know, we've seen it not be a force for good in many ways in African nations, you know, in previous administrations of some of the larger sports organizations. But, you know, how can it be a force for good? And again, that comes back to the values equation, I think.
We do have quite some questions on how to deal and overcome fear, like the example of the Mount Everest earthquake, but also in game situations or in organizations. How do you look like leadership should handle fear in general?
Well, first prepare for it, I think. Prepare for situations. You know, scenario-based training helps familiarize people with difficult situations, you know, first. Second, you know, analogies I use, one is I've had a chance to work with the Navy SEALs, SEAL Team Six, and you know, clearly they're going into battle situations, so there is a lot of, and you know, human beings are human beings, they're not fearless, they act fearlessly, but they're not fearless. So how do they deal with that? They deal it through the oldest art of them all, which is breathing, box breathing. You know, in on three, hold on three, or in on four, hold for four, out on four, hold for four, slow it down, regulate. You know, there's both a focus of attention that comes from breathing, the yogic practice, if you like, but also, you know, science shows that it regulates heart rate, it defeats cortisol, it drops, adrenaline drops. So they're busy kind of doing hippie breathing before they go and kick down a door and shoot somebody in the face twice. So if it works for them, I think it kind of works for most people, I would say. So there's that, there's the prioritization, if you like, of experience and putting us in situations, high pressure situations. And there's also the All Blacks talk about it as redhead, bluehead. Because fear, of course, is choking, and it tends to be based on future-based thinking. What will happen if? You know, what will happen if we lose? You know, what will happen if I drop the ball? What will happen in the game? But again, and this principle is the same, coming back to the base, coming back to the breath. So the All Blacks talk about redhead choking, and my best analogy is, you know, you're driving to a game, or you're driving to a meeting and you're running late and you're going, how am I going to get there? Where am I going to park? How's the meeting going to go? And then it's going to go badly. We're not going to get the contract. If we don't get the contract, we can't play our players, you know, all of that kind of stuff. And it's a negative spiral, but of course, none of it's happened at that point. But as you're driving, having these thoughts, that's when you get hit by the side by a truck, because your mind's not on the road. Right. So it's about getting your mind on the road again. So the All Blacks counterpoint that with what they call blue head, being clear, on task, in the moment, horizon opens up, time slows down, you know, an optimum performance state. How do you make that shift? Interesting. The All Blacks have sort of they anchor it. It's an almost NLP practice. Richie McCaw knows that so it begins a bit with self-knowledge. Richie McCaw knows that, or knew that when he was under pressure, he would disassociate. That was his kind of fair response. So he used the haka to ground himself, to bring himself back to ground. Karen Reed would everything would go small for him. He would kind of go into his shell. So he would just look at every corner of the stadium in his own good time to, again, get the big picture and bring himself back to that moment. Brad Thorne, another player, he tended to hit people. You know, it's flight, freeze, or fight. He would tend to lash out at people. So they had Brad's bucket of water. And when he was starting to lose it, somebody would make sure he threw some water over his face to cool himself down. So whatever works begins with self-knowledge. What's your response to fear? You know, what do you go into yourself? Do you freeze or do you lash out? Know that and find ways to kind of counteract that, to come back to the moment, come back to the breath, and realize that the thoughts are going on in your head. They're not going on in your body. And from a, you know, physical sense, there's a way of managing that kind of fear and therefore pressure. Again, it's a general answer, but hopefully there's some use in that.
James, time is flying. Do you have a final thought or a word to all these sports participants, alumni here in this group for the coming period?
I missed the question.
Do you have a final thought to all our participants, especially our sports leaders for the coming period?
Yeah, I think, you know, kind of play big. You know, what's the ultimate impact that on a social level that you can have? You know, I think it's very easy that, you know, empty stadiums, protracted bubbles, 11 month in a bubble, you know, what's it all about? You know, but to really create meaning, I think, for your teams. You know, I really like the VUCA, that VUCA kind of diagram. You know, in a volatile, uncertain, complex and ambiguous world, you know, create clarity of vision, create buy-in from people, be compassionate and care for your people. And you'll get the agility that you need to be able to respond and adapt to whatever the world throws at you. And in the end, the most adaptive and responsive teams and organizations at the moment are the ones who are going to be able to survive and thrive in difficult circumstances. And it begins with that sense of clarity of vision. And I think if that vision is purposeful, is it plays big enough, then it will take people along with you. So, you know, the world needs leaders at the moment, and it needs good examples, and it needs hope, and it needs a sense of belief and belonging, and galvanizing forces. And sport is particularly placed to be that. And I think that's almost sport's purpose, is to tell that story to a wider world. And I think that's both a huge challenge, but a great opportunity from a performance point of view.
Wow, James. Thank you so much for this incredible, inspirational story. I mean, this is not only a great speech. Your book has been an inspiration for all our students and participants. So on behalf of all our alumni, I want to thank you for not only this great story, but also everything you've done so far. And we wish you also all the best with your two new books and everything that's ahead. Thank you so much, James.
It's a total pleasure. And thank you, everyone, for tuning in and for giving me the time to speak. I really appreciate it. Thank you, Bartel.
Thank you. Yes, time is flying, and we've reached the end of this webinar. And yes, the most important thing, we are back. The program is back, the same program, even better. And yes, we hope to see you all very often, more and more in roundtables, in the new sessions. And on behalf of my team, and I want to thank my entire team here who have organized this webinar, we wish you all the best for the coming months, and be ready. We are going after you, because spread the word, we are back. Thank you so much, and have a great weekend to all of you.